صلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله الشيخ فهد بن سليمان فهيد إن شاء الله. He's going to begin إن شاء الله talking the lecture today. The lecture tonight إن شاء الله تعالى is about the generation of the Sahaba before and after Islam. So we're going to إن شاء الله begin now until about 7:30 إن شاء الله. And then we're going to break for عشاء. And then after that we'll have dinner إن شاء الله. If anybody has questions, inshallah, you're asked to write them and then submit them up here, inshallah, that way we'll have, that way we can make sure that there are no repetitions.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه. وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يجعل هذا اللقاء لقاء مباركا خالصا لوجهه سبحانه وتعالى، وأن يسلك بنا جميعا سبيل أهل الإيمان والتقوى الذي منتهاه إلى الجنة بإذن الله.
الشيخ رضي الله عنه begins by praising Allah سبحانه وتعالى and then sending salah and salam, peace and blessings on Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and making dua that inshallah we can all attain taqwa as a means for us to enter into Jannah.
حديثنا هذه الليلة حفظكم الله عن قوم قد حطوا رحالهم في الجنة، قوم هم أشرف الناس بعد الأنبياء هم أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The lecture tonight, inshallah, is about some people or a group of individuals that have already put their feet down in Jannah. They've already stepped into Jannah. These are people that are the best people after the prophets and after the messengers, and they are the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
حديثنا عن قوم أثنى الله عليهم، مدحهم الله عز وجل، أحبهم الله عز وجل، رضي الله عنهم كما في القرآن العظيم.
We're talking about people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has praised. He has, you know, talked about their good qualities. He loves them, and he has praised them in the Quran, in the noble Quran.
بل أن إن الله أمر المسلمين بسلوك صراطهم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. فهم أول من أنعم الله عليه هم الصحابة لأنهم أسلموا وآمنوا بالرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Allah Azza wa Jalla, He orders all the Muslims that they should follow the path of the Sahaba. When He mentioned in Surah Al-Fatiha, "Salat al-Ladina an'amta alayhim," the path of those who you have favored, meaning, of those whom you have favored, not those who have earned your anger, and not those who are misguided. The Sahaba are the first people to have earned the or have followed the path that earns the pleasure of Allah Subhanahu wa Taala.
"Salat al-Ladina an'am Allahu alayhim." هم محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم رسول الله وهكذا أصحابه رضي الله عنهم وفي مقدمتهم السابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار.
The path that's mentioned in the Quran in Salat al-Mustaqim, that it's straight path, is the path of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then after him is the path of the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And foremost among the companions are the foremost individuals that made hijrah from Mecca to Medina. They migrated from Mecca to Medina, and those that were in Medina at that time, known as the Ansar, the helpers of the Prophet ﷺ, and the helpers of those migrating.
ومن أوائل المنعم عليهم من أسلم في أول أمر وفي مقدمتهم أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه.
The best of those of these individuals of the companions is the one that accepted Islam during the beginning era of Islam. And he is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala, may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased.
ولهذا بعض العلماء استنبط من هذه الآية في سورة الفاتحة الرد على الرافضة، لأنه أول من أسلم وآمن بالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أبو بكر الصديق، فهو ممن أنعم الله عليهم وأمرنا بالاقتداء بهم.
So from this ayah, from the verse in Surah Al-Fatiha, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to seek the path of those that He has favored, the scholars have taken from this ayah, they've taken a response to the Shia, the Rafida, the Shiites, those that they, you know, they attack Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, because if the Prophet Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling us to follow those whom He has favored, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq is one of the first whom He has favored with Islam.
وفي هذا يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى مادحا لهم والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه.
And in praising the Sahaba, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the foremost muhajirin, the foremost migrants from Mecca to Medina, and the Ansar, and those who follow them in their goodness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وقوله تعالى والذين تبعوهم بإحسان تنبيه لكل الأمة أن تكون من هذه الطائفة، أي اتبع طريقة الصحابة رضي الله عنهم بإحسان.
When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about those who have followed them in goodness, this is a notification to all the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they should be among those who follow these companions in their good method.
ويقول بعض السلف عليكم بالسبيل والسنة فإنه ما من عبد على سبيل وسنة ذكر الله عز وجل ففاضت عيناه إلا حطت عنه خطاياه كما تحط الورقة كما تحط الشجرة ورقها.
And some of the scholars from the pious practices used to say, follow the straight path and follow the sunnah, because anybody who follows the straight path and the sunnah, and who when they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, their eyes shed tears, their sins fall off of them just as leaves fall off of a tree.
فالسنه هي سنه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم والسبيل هو سبيل الصحابه رضي الله عنهم.
So the sunnah mentioned in that narration is the sunnah of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the path mentioned is the path of the Sahaba, of the companions.
والدليل على هذا قوله تعالى ومن يشاقق الرسول من بعد ما تبين له الهدى ويتبع غير سبيل المؤمنين نوليه ما تولى ونصليه جهنم وساءت مصيرا.
And the evidence of that is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says whoever conflicts with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after the guidance has been made clear to them and follows a path other than that of the believers, then we're going to let them continue to go in the way that they're going, and we will allow them to go to Jahannam, to hellfire, and that is the worst area or their worst final resting place.
ومن الأحاديث حول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خير الناس قومي ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم.
And among the ahadith that explain the virtue of the Sahaba is when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said the best of generations is mine, then those who follow them, then those who follow them.
وأيضا حديث العرباض بن سارية لما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام فعليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين من بعدي.
And also the hadith of العرباض بن سارية and the Sahaba who reports that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said follow my path and the path of the rightly guided خلفاء caliphs after me.
هؤلاء الصحابة رضي الله عنهم إذا تأملنا حالهم قبل الإسلام ماذا كانوا عليه ثم ماذا صاروا بعدما من الله عليهم بالإسلام.
These Sahaba, we can look at their situations before Islam, and then we can look at their situations after Allah Azza wa Jalla favored them with the gift of Islam.
كان الناس والعرب قبل الإسلام قبل مبعث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على أحوال سيئة مظلمة.
Before Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was sent, they were in a very dark state, a very terrible state.
كانوا في جاهلية جهلاء وعماية وضلالة وانحراف في كل الأمور.
They were in a complete state of ignorance and blindness and misguidance in every type of sin, in every type of any type of part of life.
إذا أردنا أمور العقيدة كانوا أو بحثنا في أمور العقيدة.
If we were to research their matters in عقيدة and their beliefs.
كان منهم من يعبد الصالحين والأولياء.
Some of them used to worship the righteous people and those that were close to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala.
ومنهم من يعبد الأنبياء.
Some of them used to worship prophets.
والأصنام هي عبارة عن صور لهؤلاء.
And the idols that they used to make were a representation of or a manifestation of those individuals that they used to worship.
فكان عند العرب صنم يقال له ود وسواع ويغوث ويعوق ونسر وهؤلاء كانوا رجالا صالحين في قوم نوح.
And for example, some of the Arabs used to worship some of these five idols that are mentioned, which are Wad and Suwa' and Ya'uth and Nasr. And these were righteous individuals from the people of Nuh alayhi salam.
وعظموهم حتى صوروا صورهم ثم عبدوهم وهذا أصل عبادة الأصنام تعظيم الصالحين والغلو فيهم.
So they honored these individuals and then they made idols out of them and then they worshipped them. And this is the origin of the worship of why the idols were worshipped, is that they honored the righteous individuals beyond what they were doing.
وكان منهم من يعبد الأحجار واللات هذه أصلها حجر في الطائف.
Some of them used to worship rocks and اللات, the famous idol from Quraysh, was just a piece of rock from a Taif.
وقال بعض العلماء اللات اسم وصف رجل كان يلت السويق للحجاج يخلط السويق والسويق هو البر الذي يطحن ويخلط مع التمر أو العسل ويطبخ ثم يعطى الحجاج كان يعني محسنا فمات فعكفوا على قبره ثم عبدوه فسمي اللات.
And they say that Allat was called after somebody that he used to do something. He used to prepare some sort of a date and grain dish or a date and honey dish, and he would give it and he would cook it, and then he would give it to those that were coming pilgrimage making Hajj. So he was a very respected and somebody that used to do good for those that made pilgrimage. So the people, they honored him, and then it ended up the fact that they would worship him.
والعزة شجرة عبارة عن شجرات أو ثلاث شجرات مجتمعة كانوا يطلقون عليها اسم العزة فكانوا يعبدونها من دون الله.
And al-uzza is a tree, was a tree or a group of trees that they used to worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or that they used to honor, and they began to worship these trees besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ومنات هذه الصخرة بيضاء منقوشة عليها نقوش عظموها وغلوا فيها وعبدوها من دون الله.
And al-lat or manat was a giant stone that was it was sculpted or had some sort of sculpting in it, and they took that and they worshipped it besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ومنهم من كان يعبد أحجارا يأخذها سبب عبادتهم لها بداية هو التدرج من الشيطان في الغلو. يأخذون حجارة من الحرم يقولون شوقا للحرم إذا سافرنا حتى نرى الحجارة فنشتاق إلى الكعبة.
Some of them used to worship stones that they would take, and this is a type of shaitan making it in levels or making it in stages. They would slowly evolve into worshiping idols. They would take a stone from the Kaaba when they would leave, or they would take a stone from Mecca, and then they would say, well, we're taking this because we long for Mecca, we want it to be next to us. Then they would end up, the final result would be that they worship this stone besides Allah subhanahu
wa ta'ala. فطوفوا بهذه الحجارة كأنكم طفتم بالكعبة.
So the shaitan, he whispered to them and he told them, well, you're making tawaf, you're circling the Kaaba, and this rock is made of the same material, the same rock that the Kaaba was made of, so why don't you just make tawaf, make circling, circle around this rock.
حتى من سخافة عقولهم أنهم إذا أرادوا أن يطبخوا طبخا جمعوا ثلاثة أربعة أحجار فثلاثة أحجار جعلوها للقدر والرابع لأجل أن يعبدوهم من دون الله.
To the point of their stupidity, you could say, that when they wanted to make a dish, they wanted to cook, they would get four rocks to use for cooking. Three of these rocks would be for cooking, and one of them would be so that they can worship it beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وهكذا تنوع بهم تلاعب الشيطان. وإذا أردت أن تقف على مزيد من هذه الصور الجاهلية فارجع إلى كتاب إغاثة الأحفاد من مصائد الشيطان لابن القيم الجوزية. فقد ذكر في الجزء الثاني أنواع كثيرة من تلاعب الشيطان بالكفار قبل الإسلام.
So these are some of the various ways that the shaitan made these individuals worship idols besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you want more information on that, you can go to a book called إغاثة اللهفان by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah.
من مصائد الشيطان.
إغاثة اللهفان من مصائد الشيطان by Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah. And he mentions in the second volume the various ways that the mushrikeen, the polytheists of the Arabs, were deceived into worshipping idols besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وَكَانَ مِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَعْبُدُوا الشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرِ كَمَا قَالَ اللَّهُ عَزَّ جَلْ لَا تَسْجُدُوا لِلشَّمْسِ وَلَا لِلْقَمَرِ وَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ الَّذِي خَلَقَهُنَّ إِن كُنْتُمْ إِيَّاهُ تَعْبُدُونَ.
Others, other people from those times used to worship the sun and the moon. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do not prostrate to the sun and the moon, but prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that has created both the sun and the moon.
المقصود أنهم كانوا على طرق مختلفة في أبواب العبادة كلها من الشرك.
The point of all this is that just to mention and make notice of the fact that they were all on various methods or various ways, but all of them were engaged in their own respective way of polytheism.
ولم يكن فيهم موحد إلا أفراد معدودين يقال أربعة أو ثلاثة وهؤلاء يعني كانوا ينبذون ولا يقبل منهم قول.
And there were none among them that used to unify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship, except for maybe three or four, and these individuals were ostracized and they were kicked out, and nothing was, they weren't listened to, nobody would listen to what they say.
وفي هذا حديث عياض المجاشعي يقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الله عز وجل إن الله عز وجل نظر إلى أهل الأرض عربهم وعجمهم فمقتهم إلا بقايا من أهل الكتاب بقايا أفراد معدودين خمسة أو أربعة ونحوهم.
And evidence for this is the hadith of عياض رضي الله تعالى عنه, who says that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said that Allah عز وجل looked at the people on earth
And he hated all of them, except for some small individuals or small groups from the people of books that from the people of the book that used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ومنهم زيد بن النفيل ومنهم قس بن ساعدة وهؤلاء كانوا لا يقبل منهم دعوتهم إلى التوحيد وكانوا منبوذين ثم ماتوا ولم يبقى أحد ممن يدعو إلى التوحيد.
Some of the ones that stayed that were monotheistic were Zayd ibn Nufayl and
قس بن ساعدة.
قس بن ساعدة and others that used to say, but after they died, during their life, nobody listened to them, and after they died, whatever they had, the monotheism that they had, it all died along with them.
ومع هذا مع هذا كان هؤلاء المشركون كان هؤلاء المشركون يقرون بالربوبية مع كونهم يعبدون القمر أو يعبدون الشمس أو يعبدون الصالحين إلا أنهم كانوا يعترفون بأن الله خالقهم.
Despite all of this, despite the fact that they used to worship stones or used to worship idols or used to worship these things, they used to still admit the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created them. They used to respect or they used to acknowledge the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord.
ولم تنفعهم هذه لم ينفعهم هذا الإقرار ولم ينفعهم توحيد الربوبية لأنهم أشركوا في الألوهية.
And this will not benefit them and it did not benefit them the fact that they realized or acknowledged that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator because they made polytheism with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they associated partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worship.
وأنتم تعرفون قصة عبد المطلب عم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما جاء أبرهة بجيشه العرمرم يريد هدم الكعبة فجاء يناقشه ويطالبه بالإبل فقال تناقشني في الإبل ونحن نريد أن نهزم أو أن نهجم على الكعبة فقال أنا رب الإبل يعني أنا صاحب الإبل وللبيت رب يحميه.
And the evidence for that is the story, the famous story of Abd al-Muttalib, who when Abraha, the Ethiopian, he came to attack the Kaaba, he went, and when Abd al-Muttalib, he went out to go and have some negotiations with him, he told him, I'm going to give you some camels and so forth. Abraha said, are you talking to me about camels when I'm going to go attack the Kaaba now? So Abd al-Muttalib said, I am the owner of these camels, and the house, the Kaaba, has an owner that will protect it, meaning Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وفي القرآن العظيم يقول الله ولئن سألتهم من خلقهم لا يقولون الله فأنا يفكون.
And in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you were to ask them who created them, then they would say Allah.
فأنا يفكون. يعني كيف يصرفون عن هذا؟ ويعبدون غيره.
So how are they going? So how do they turn away from this and worship other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
والمقصود يا إخواني أننا نعرف أن الإقرار بتوحيد الربوبية كان قديما موجودا. لكن الشأن كله ودعوة الرسل في إخلاص العبادة لله عز وجل وإفراده بالعبادة.
So we can note through all this that affirmation of lordship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the fact that He created was something that was it wasn't something new. It was something that was preceded by by long generations. So that means that the message of the messengers was to make individuals worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone in terms of directing all worship to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فلا يكفي أن يدعي العبد أنه يعرف الله بل يجب أن يضيف إلى ذلك أن يخص الله بالعبادة.
So it's not enough for an individual to say that they know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but actually they have to specifically and specially make their worship exclusive for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
ولهذا إبليس اللعين هو يعرف الله عز وجل ولم تنفعه هذه المعرفة وفرعون أقر بآيات الله ولم ينفعه هذا الإقرار وكفار قريش أيضا اعترفوا بربوبية الله ولم ينفعهم فلا ينبغي للإنسان أن تختلط عليه الأمور فعليه أن يعرف أن دعوة الرسل هي أعبدوا الله ما لكم من إله غيره.
You'll find Iblis, he knew Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but that didn't benefit him. He knew of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but that didn't benefit him. Likewise, Fir'aun, Pharaoh, he knew of the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he knew of Allah jalla wa ala, but it didn't benefit him. And likewise, the kuffar of Quraysh, the believers of Quraysh, the polytheists, they recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as being their creator. That's why we should not, confuse these matters, but we should make sure that we know that the entire message of the prophets is worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because you do not have a deity, you do not have anything worthy of worship besides Him.
كانت الخرافة كثيرة جدا في الناس قبل الإسلام.
Fairy tales and these types of things, these fake stories and all that, these were things that were well known and very widespread before Islam.
السحر كان منتشرا فيهم.
Likewise, they were very indulged in magic.
في كل قبيلة وكل حي من أحياء العرب يوجد كاهن أو أكثر من كاهن.
In every neighborhood, in every area of the Arabs, there would be more than one soothsayer, more than one magician.
كانوا إذا نزل المطر ينسبون هذا إلى النجم والنجوم.
If it rained, they would say that it's because of the stars.
كانوا يعتقدون أن النجوم تؤثر.
They used to believe that the stars they have an effect on life.
كانوا في الجاهلية إذا كسفت الشمس يقولون ولد ملك أو مات ملك.
They would say that whenever the moon would be a lunar eclipse, they would say that a king has died or a king has been born.
إلى آخر تلك الخرافات العظيمة التي تنتشر بينهم.
And including all these other different fairy tales that they used to believe in that were very widespread among them.
إذا انتقلنا إلى المعاملات. كان الربا متفشيا ومنتشرا بينهم.
If we were to look at their dealings, we could see that usury, interest, was something that was very widespread.
والغش والخيانة والخداع.
And cheating and treachery and lying.
كان القوي يأكل الضعيف.
The strong person would basically consume the weak person.
هكذا إذا انتقلنا إلى أمور النكاح والزواج.
If we were to look at matters pertaining to sexual intercourse or marriage.
كانوا في الجاهلية كان الزنا متفشيا ومنتشرا بينهم.
You find that fornication was something and adultery was something that was very widespread among them.
كانوا يشربون الخمور ويعاقرونها.
They used to be very indulgent in drinking alcohol.
كان الرجل ينكح امرأة أبيه ولا يبالي ويرث مال أبيه.
A person would marry the wife of his father and he wouldn't even care, he wouldn't even inherit the wealth of the father after that.
دون إخوته الصغار.
And he would inherit from his father and would keep that away from his younger siblings.
وهكذا في القضاء والفصل فيما بينهم كانوا يتحاكمون إلى الطواغيت.
Also, in terms of how they used to judge between one another, they used to go and reference all their problems back to these things that worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Tawaghi.
فَلَمَّا بَعَثَ اللَّهُ مُحَمَّدًا صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَخْرَجَهُمُ اللَّهُ عَزَّلْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ.
When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, He took them from the darkness into the light.
مِنَ الشِّرْكِ إِلَى التَّوْحِيدِ.
He took them from polytheism to monotheism.
من الكفر إلى الإيمان.
He took them from disbelief to belief.
عرفوا الله بأسمائه وصفاته فأخلصوا له العبادة.
They knew Allah, so they came to know of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His names and attributes, so they unified Him in worship.
علمهم الله عز وجل شرائع الإسلام والإيمان.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught them the legislation of Islam and faith.
الصلاة، الزكاة، الصوم، الحج، الجهاد، الأمر بالمعروف، النهي عن المنكر. وبقية شعائر الإسلام.
Such as prayer, Hajj, fasting, giving charity, jihad, ordering good, forbidding evil, and all other legislations of Islam.
بالله عليكم قوم كانوا في الصحراء قوم كان يأكل بعضهم بعضا انتقلوا بسبب هذا الدين فصاروا أعز الناس وأقوى الناس وأشرف الناس.
And keep in mind that these are people that were in the desert that used to fight one another. Very humiliated people, they became through Islam the most honored people and the most mighty of people.
قال الله عز وجل لقد من الله على المؤمنين إذ بعث فيهم رسولا من أنفسهم يتلو عليهم آياته ويزكيهم ويعلمهم الكتاب والحكمة وإن كانوا من قبل لفي ضلال مبين.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said Allah عز وجل has favored the believers by sending them a messenger that teaches them the book and the sunnah and it teaches them that wisdom. And even though before that, they were in a great deal of misguidance.
هؤلاء أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هم أشرف الناس بعد الرسل وأفضلهم.
These companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم are the most honored people after the messengers and the most noble people after the messengers.
قال تعالى محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم.
Allah عز وجل says Muhammad is the messenger of Allah and those that are with him, his companions, are stern against disbelievers and they are merciful among one another.
وقوله سبحانه والذين معه يعني الصحابة.
When Allah سبحانه وتعالى says those that are with him, meaning his companions.
وهذا يدل يعني يجرنا إلى بحث مسألة عند علماء الحديث من هو الصحابي.
And that brings us to the topic that many scholars of hadith talk about, which is who is a Sahabi? What is a Sahabi?
أحد يستطيع أن يجاوب من الإخوة؟
Can anybody answer who a companion is?
تعريف الصحابي. تفضل.
الصحابي هو الذي كان يعني كان المقربين من الرسول المقربين من الإسلام.
He says, a Sahabi, somebody that was close to the Messenger of Allah or close to Islam.
لا. خلاص هيك. شوف هيك. تعريف الصحابي.
What's the definition of a Sahabi, a companion?
هو من لقي النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم مؤمنا به ومات على الإسلام.
It's the individual that they met the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم while they were believing in him and then they died in the same state that they met him.
لقي لو لقاء قليلا.
They met him even if it's for a small short period of time.
لأن هذا الشرف لا يعدله شرف.
Because this honor is not comparable to any other honor.
هذا اللقاء ليس كأي لقاء.
This meeting that they had with him is not like any other meeting that you have with anybody else.
والدليل عليه من القرآن هذه الآية الكريمة التي قرأناها في سورة الفتح.
And the evidence for that is the ayah that we just said from Surah Al-Fatih.
محمد رسول الله والذين معه.
Muhammad is the Messenger of Allah and those that are with him.
فأدنى معية تكون بأدنى لقاء.
So,
أدنى معية.
The slightest way to say that they're with him is can be with the slightest, smallest meeting.
فالذي قدم من مكان بعيد إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في المدينة أو في مكة أو في حجة الوداع. فإنه بهذا اللقاء وبهذه الرؤية للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يكون معه بمقدار هذه المعية له شرف الصحبة.
So anybody that travels from far distances to come meet the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and they came and they met him, then they would be included within this even if it was in the slightest of ways.
فهذا تعديل من الله لهم وتوثيق من الله عز وجل لهم وتفضيل.
So this is the way of Allah عز وجل praising them and declaring them as trustworthy and virtuous.
والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم.
And those that are with him, Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, those that are with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم are stern and rough and tough against the disbelievers, and they are merciful among each other.
تراهم ركعا سجدا.
You see them prostrating and making sujood, bowing.
يبتغون فضلا من ربهم ورضوانا.
They seek virtue from, or they seek some bounties from their Lord, and they seek His pleasure.
سيماهم في وجوههم من أثر السجود.
You see their marks on their face, or you can see them by their face because of the marks of their sujood, of their prostration.
ذلك مثلهم في التوراة.
That is their example and their similitude that was given to them in the Torah.
يعني أن هذا المثل مذكور في التوراة.
That meaning that the example that was given is the one that is mentioned in the Torah.
يعني ذكر في التوراة صفة الصحابة.
Meaning in the Torah, the characteristic of the Sahaba was mentioned.
ثم قال سبحانه وتعالى ومثلهم في الإنجيل كزرع.
And then Allah جل وعلا continues, He says, and their similitude in the Injil in the Bible is like a vegetation.
أخرج شطأه فآزره فاستغلظ فاستوى على سوقه.
That if it reaches its full potential,
يعجب الزراع ليغيظ بهم الكفار.
It makes the farmers happy, but it makes the disbelievers upset and angry.
فهذه الآية الكريمة في ثناء من الله عز وجل على الصحابة وتعديل من الله للصحابة فهم كلهم عدول رضي الله عنهم وارضاهم.
So this ayah is a type of, it's a praise of the Sahaba and is declaring all of them to be upright in terms of their character.
لكن بعضهم أفضل من بعض.
However, some of them were better than others.
فأفضل الصحابة أبو بكر ثم عمر ثم عثمان ثم علي رضي الله عنهم أجمعين.
So the greatest of Sahaba is first Abu Bakr and then Umar and then Uthman and then Ali. May Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with them all.
وهكذا العشرة المبشرون بالجنة.
Likewise, the ten that were guaranteed Jannah are also some of the best of Sahaba.
وهكذا أهل بدر.
Likewise, the people that fought in Badr were also of the best of the Sahaba.
وأصحاب أحد وغزوة الأحزاب.
Likewise, those that fought in Uhud and in the battle of the Confederates are also some of the best of the Sahaba.
والمهاجرون مقدمون على الأنصار.
And the migrants, those that migrated from Mecca to Medina, are given precedence over the Ansar, over those who are already residing in Medina.
والذين أسلموا قبل فتح مكة هم أفضل ممن أسلم بعد فتح مكة.
And those that accepted Islam before Mecca was conquered are better than those that accepted Islam after Mecca was conquered.
فهذا في التفاضل بينهم.
So this is in how to determine who is best among them.
لكنهم كلهم رضي الله عنهم أهل فضل وعدالة.
However, all of them in general are people of fadl, of virtue, and of uprightness.
فهذا يعني إشارة إلى ما كان قبل الإسلام. أما أحوالهم بعدما من الله عليهم بالإسلام فشيء يفوق الوصف.
So this is before Islam. As for after Allah Azza wa Jal gave them Islam, then it's something that is almost indescribable.
في الاعتقاد وفي الأخلاق وفي المعاملات وفي جميع الأمور الدين.
In terms of their beliefs and the way that they dealt with one another and the way that they had in their mannerisms and characteristics and all matters pertaining to the religion.
ولهذا يقول الإمام أحمد رحمه الله في الرسالة المشهورة باسم أصول السنة.
That's why Imam Ahmad رحمه الله he mentions in his small book known as أصول السنة.
السنة عندنا التمسك بما كان عليه أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
He says the sunnah to us, the sunnah is to hold fast to what the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم were on.
ولهذا العقيدة التي كان عليها الصحابة هي التي يجب التمسك بها.
That's why the belief system that was followed by the Sahaba is the one that must be adhered to.
وهذه هي عقيدة السلف الصالح.
And this is the belief of the pious predecessors.
عقيدة أهل السنة والجماعة.
The beliefs of the people of Sunnah and congregation and the Sunnah والجماعة.
وهي مخالفة لعقائد الشيعة والخوارج والمرجئة والقدرية.
And they are contrary and contradictory to the beliefs of all other sects such as the Shia, the Khawarij and other sects, the Murji'a was another sect, and the Qadariya, those that deny the Qadr, the predestination, is contrary to all of these different beliefs.
ولهذا أهل البدع لا بد من كثير منهم أن يقع في بعض من الصحابة بالغمز واللمز والطعن.
That's why some of the people of innovation they have to talk bad about the Sahaba in some sort of way. They either disparage them or they speak bad about their character and so forth.
ومحبة الصحابة دين وإيمان وبغض الصحابة كفر ونفاق كما قال الطحاوي رحمه الله.
And loving the Sahaba is faith and hating them is a type of hypocrisy.
فعلامة أهل البدع الوقوع في أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم.
A sign that you can know someone is a person of bid'ah and innovation is that they disparage and they speak ill about the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
يقول النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام كما في صحيح البخاري.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said as has been narrated in Sahih Bukhari.
آية الإيمان علامة. آية الإيمان حب الأنصار وآية النفاق بغض الأنصار.
He said that a sign of faith is for an individual to love the Ansar and a sign of hypocrisy is for somebody to hate the Ansar.
فإذا أحببت الصحابة أيها المسلم فأنت معهم بإذن الله عز وجل.
So if you love the Sahaba, O Muslim, then you will be with them by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
فقد جاء رجل يسأل النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سؤالا مهما وأجاب عليه بجواب مهم.
An individual came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and asked him a very important question and he responded to him with a very important answer.
قال له يا رسول الله الرجل يحب القوم ولما يلحق بهم.
He said that, O Allah's Messenger, an individual loves the people but he's unable to reach them.
لما في لغة العرب غير لم. لما يعني أوشك يقارب أن يلحق بهم لكن لا يستطيع اللحاق بهم. لم نفي تام. أما لما يعني يريد أن يعمل مثل أعمالهم لكن يعجز.
The word that was used in Arabic is not that he's not like them, but he's trying to be like them, but he's just unable to reach the level.
الرجل يحب القوم ولما يلحق بهم فقال له النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المرء مع من أحب يوم القيامة.
So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم responded to this individual. He said a person will be on the day of resurrection with those that he loves.
راوي الحديث هو أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه.
The narrator of the hadith is Anas ibn Malik رضي الله تعالى عنه.
يقول أنس رضي الله عنه فما فرحنا بشيء فرحنا بقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم المرء مع من أحب يوم القيامة.
So we never became Anas رضي الله تعالى عنه, who says that we never became happier after we never became as happy as we did when we heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم say that an individual will be with those that he loves.
يقول أنس رضي الله عنه فأنا أحب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وأحب أبا بكر وأحب عمر وأرجو أن أكون معهم.
So Anas رضي الله عنه said, I love the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم and I love Abu Bakr and I love Umar and I hope that I'm with them on the day of resurrection.
ونحن نقول لنا ولأنفسنا ولأهلينا ولكم ولجميع المسلمين أحب أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولا يكون في قلبي أحد من المسلمين شيء على الصحابة رضي الله عنهم حتى بإذن الله يحشر معهم يوم القيامة.
And we say to everybody that we remind ourselves and we remind our families and all the Muslims that you have to love the Messenger of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and don't have any small amount of hatred in your heart for them so that we can be with them on the day of resurrection.
يقول عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله تعالى عنه.
عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه says,
إن أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم هم أبر هذه الأمة قلوبا.
He says that the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم were the ones that had the most pious and righteous of hearts. And they had the deepest of knowledge. And they had the least amount of going overboard.
قوم اختارهم الله عز وجل لصحبة نبيه صلى الله عليه وسلم.
There are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to become to accompany His Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
قوم اختارهم الله لصحبة نبيه ونصرة دينه.
And He also chose them to give victory and to aid His religion.
فعرفوا لهم قدرهم.
So give them their due rights and their positions.
وتأسوا بما استطعتم من هديهم.
And follow them in whatever you're able to. Follow their guidance as much as you're able.
فإنهم كانوا على الهدي المستقيم.
Because they were on the straight guidance.
إنهم كانوا على الهدي المستقيم.
They were on the straight guidance.
هؤلاء الصحابة هم أفضل هذه الأمة وخيرها رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم.
So these Sahaba were the best of this Ummah, the best of this nation, and they were the most virtuous. So may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with them.
ومن الصحابة أهل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Of the Sahaba, or included within the broad category of the Sahaba, the companions, are the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
وأهل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هم أقاربه المسلمون.
The family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam are include those that are related to him that were Muslims.
وأزواجه.
And as well as his wives.
وذريته.
As well as his offspring.
فهؤلاء هم أهل بيت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
So they are the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
وهم آل علي.
And they are the family of Ali.
وآل عقيل.
And the family of عقيل.
وآل جعفر.
And the family of جعفر.
وآل العباس.
And the family of العباس.
وبني الحارث بن عبد المطلب.
And the children of الحارث بن عبد المطلب.
وكذلك جميع أزواج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وهن أمهات المؤمنين.
Also, all of the wives of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم are the mothers of the believers.
خصوصا أفضلهم خديجة وعائشة رضي الله عنهما وعن جميع الصحابة.
Especially and especially the most virtuous of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were Khadija and Aisha, may Allah be pleased with them, and all the other Sahaba.
Khadija radiyallahu anha ummu akthar awladih.
Khadija was the mother of most of his children.
Wa awwalu man amana bihi wa 'adadah.
She was the first that believed in him and the first that aided him.
Wa kana laha minhu al-manzil al-'aliyah.
And she was very highly regarded by him.
Wa basharaha Jibril 'ala lisan an-nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. بيت في الجنة من قصب لا صخب فيه ولا نصب.
And Jibreel عليه السلام he guaranteed her through the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم a house in paradise.
وكذلك أم المؤمنين الصديقة بنت الصديق عائشة بنت أبي بكر رضي الله عنهما.
Also we have عائشة the صديقة the truthful one, the daughter of the صديق the truthful one, أبو بكر. May Allah عز وجل be pleased with her.
التي قال فيها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فضل عائشة على النساء كفضل الثريد على سائر الطعام.
The one that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said about her, the virtue that Aisha has over all other women is like ثريد, which is a type of dish that the Arabs used to like. It's that dish is better than all other dishes.
هؤلاء الصحابة قاموا بحفظ الدين ونصرة الإسلام.
So these Sahaba they preserved the religion and they aided the religion.
هاجروا وجاهدوا في سبيل الله.
They fought and they migrated for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
لو نظر الإنسان في سيرتهم بعلم وبصيرة وفضائلهم.
If somebody were to look at their biographies with knowledge and insight and to look at their virtues,
علم أنهم خير القرون.
They would know that they are the best of generations.
لا كان ولا يكون مثلهم.
There was never and there will never be a generation like them.
ولا يمكن للمتأخر أن يلحق بهم.
Nobody that came after them will ever reach them.
وهم الصفوة من قرون هذه الأمة.
They are the best among the generations of this Ummah.
لكن عسى المجتهد من المتأخرين أن يقتدي بهم فإن هذا هو الكمال في حقه.
However, somebody that comes after them, they have the opportunity to try to act as they did, so that way they can try to catch up to them.
إذ شرف الصحبة لا يعدله شرف.
Because the virtue of being with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم has nothing comparable to it.
ولهذا سئل أحد العلماء أيهما أفضل معاوية بن أبي سفيان رضي الله عنه وهو صحابي أم عمر بن عبد العزيز وهو معروف أنه من الحكام الصالحين والخلفاء الراشدين المعروفين بالسيرة الحسنة. سئل بالمقارنة أيهما أفضل معاوية أم عمر بن عبد العزيز.
And that's why some of the scholars were asked about who is better معاوية بن أبي سفيان, the companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, Or Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, another who is one of the pious leaders of the Muslims, and he was asked, who's better, Muawiyah or Umar ibn Abdul Aziz?
فقال غبار دخل في أنف معاوية في غزوة مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أفضل من ملء الأرض من عمر بن عبد العزيز.
He said that a small piece of dust that went into the nose of Muawiyah fighting alongside the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم is better than an earth spill of عمر بن عبد العزيز.
فالمقصود أننا نعرف فضل الصحابة رضي الله عنهم وسيرتهم العطرة.
So we should learn about the Sahaba and we should learn about their very beautiful lives.
ولو أردنا أن نتكلم عن فضائلهم فضيلة فضيلة لم يتسع لا مجلس ولا مجالس كثيرة لأن هذا باب واسع.
If we wanted to speak about their virtues and we're going to speak about each one of them individually, it would not be enough for just one lecture. It wouldn't be enough for many lectures.
لكن نعطيكم المراجع في هذا الموضوع المهم.
However, we're going to give you some references for you to go back on this important topic.
فممكن أن ترجع إلى كتاب صحيح البخاري.
For example, you can go and reference back to صحيح البخاري.
وفيه كتاب فضائل الصحابة.
And in that book is the chapter of the virtues of the Sahaba.
وذكر فيه فضائل الصحابة عموما.
And he mentions the general virtues of the Sahaba.
وذكر فيه فضائل المهاجرين.
And he mentions some of the virtues of the Muhajirin, the Migrants.
والأنصار.
As well as those who were present in Medina, the Ansar.
وبقية الصحابة.
As well as the rest of the Sahaba.
ثم ذكر فيه فضيلة بعض الصحابة بعينه كأبي بكر وعمر إلى آخره.
And then he mentions the virtues of some individual Sahaba, such as Abu Bakr and Umar and so on.
وهكذا في صحيح مسلم سلك مثل ما سلك الإمام البخاري رحمه الله.
Likewise in Sahih Muslim, Imam Muslim رحمه الله, he took the same method that Bukhari رحمه الله took.
وكذلك الكتب المصنفة في السنن كسنن النسائي وأبي داود والترمذي وابن ماجه كلها يذكر فيها فضائل الصحابة رضي الله عنهم على هذا الطريقة.
And likewise the books that are mentioned or the books that have been written that gather the sunnah, they gather the hadith, such as Ibn Majah, Tirmidhi, for example. They also mention virtues of the Sahaba, and you can go back and refer to these books.
ومن الكتب المفيدة أيضا فضائل الصحابة للإمام أحمد بن حنبل.
Likewise, one of the beneficial books is the virtues of the Sahaba, فضائل الصحابة by Imam Ahmad.
وهذا مطبوع في مجلدين.
And this has been published in two volumes.
وكذلك من الكتب المفيدة كتب السيرة النبوية.
Likewise, some of the beneficial books to know about this topic are the books that deal with the biography of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
مثل كتاب السيرة لابن هشام.
Such as السيرة by Ibn Hisham.
وكذلك زاد المعاد في هدي خير العباد.
And also زاد المعاد في هدي خير العباد by
ابن القيم الجوزي رحمه الله.
By Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyya, may Allah Azza wa Jalla mercy on him.
وهذا كتاب مفيد جدا ذكر في بالنسبة للطبعة المشهورة عندنا الخمس مجلدات باللغة العربية في المجلد الثالث كله في سيرة الصحابة رضي الله عنهم.
So in the five famous in the publication that is famous that is published in five volumes, in the third volume he mentions he made it specific to the virtues of the Sahaba.
وهناك أيضا كتب أخرى في فضائل كل صحابي بعينه.
And there are other books that are dedicated to the virtues of each Sahaba individually.
فهناك فضائل أبي بكر الصديق, فضائل عمر, فضائل عثمان, فضائل علي, فضائل أبي هريرة, أبي مسعود, عائشة إلى آخره.
So there are books that mention the virtues of Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Abu Hurairah, Ibn Mas'ud, Aisha, رضي الله تعالى عنهم, and so on and so forth.
أذكر لكم يعني شيئا يسيرا يعني مقتطفات يسيرة جدا.
I'm going to mention some small slight references to these matters.
أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه كان لا يملك نفسه إذا قرأ القرآن لا يملك نفسه من البكاء.
أبو بكر الصديق whenever he would read from the Quran he would never be able to hold himself back from weeping and crying.
عمر الفاروق رضي الله عنه كان في وجهه خطان من كثرة الدموع.
عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه used to have two lines on his face like this going down because of how much he used to cry.
كان الفجر يصلي بالمسلمين فيقرأ سورا طويلة يبكر في أول الوقت ويقرأ سورة مثل النحل أو هود أو سورة يوسف.
And he would pray Fajr in the earliest of times and he would lead in a very he would lead some salat very long such as reading النحل سورة هود سورة يوسف.
كان حتى يجتمع الناس بطول السورة يبكر بالصلاة ويطول القراءة حتى يجتمع الناس.
He would make the salah early, meaning before, right at the time begins, and he would make it long so that people can attend the prayer.
فيقول أحد الصحابة يقول قرأ بسورة يوسف قرأ عمر رضي الله عنه بسورة يوسف فلما بلغ قول الله عز وجل إنما أشكو بثي وحزني إلى الله وأعلم من الله ما لا تعلمون قال فسمعنا نشيجه من وراء الصفوف. النشيج هو صوت يعني يصدر مع البكاء.
Some of the Sahaba narrated that when Umar al-Khattab was praying for one day, he read Surah Yusuf, and when he reached the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Ya'qub alayhi salam says, I complain my sorrow and my sadness to Allah, and I know from Allah what you do not know, meaning he's talking to his sons. Umar began to cry so loud that even some lines back they were hearing his wails.
وعثمان بن عفان رضي الله عنه من أيضا ما ذكر عنه أنه كان إذا وقف على القبر يعني يزور القبور فيبكي حتى لحيته تمتلئ بالدموع.
And it's narrated that when Uthman ibn Affan used to go visit graves, he would begin to cry until his beard would become wet.
فيقال له فيقول إن هذا القبر أول منزلة من منازل الآخرة فإذا صلح كان ما بعده خيرا منه.
So when he was asked about that, he said, this grave that you're looking at is the first station, the first stop in your journey in the hereafter. And if it's good in there, then everything else will be good. And if it's not good, then anything after is going to be worse than what they've already faced. And he used to read the entire Quran in one night.
أنه قرأ القرآن كاملا في ركعة.
And it's been narrated from him, from Uthman رضي الله عنه, with an authentic chain of narration that he read the entire Quran in one ركعة.
يقول واحد التابعين بكرت يوما بعد العشاء إلى المقام حتى أصلي مقام يعني خلف مقام إبراهيم.
One of the Sahaba said, I went early to the maqam of Ibrahim in Mecca in the Masjid al-Haram so I can pray.
فلما كبرت فإذا برجل من خلفي.
When I said Allahu Akbar, I began my prayer, there is a man behind me.
فعرفت أنه عثمان وهو الخليفة كان في وقتها خليفة.
And I knew that it was Uthman, the Khalifa, at that time he was the Khalifa, the leader of Muslims.
فتنحيت حتى تقدم فصلى حتى طلع الفجر.
And so I moved so that he can move forward, and he prayed and he led until Fajr prayed.
فقلت له رحمك الله صليت ركعة واحدة.
So I said to him, may Allah have mercy on you, you only prayed one ركعة.
قال إنها وتري.
He said it is my witr.
فهذا يعني شيء يسير من أخلاقهم رضي الله تعالى عنه.
So this is something that a small reference to their mannerisms and characteristics, may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with them.
أم أيمن امرأة كبيرة في السن من الصحابيات الكبيرات كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يزورها.
أم أيمن was one of the elder صحابي female صحابة that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to visit.
بعد وفاة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أبو بكر الصديق لعمر رضي الله عنه اذهب بنا نزور أم أيمن كما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يزورها.
After the death of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, أبو بكر الصديق رضي الله عنه told عمر بن الخطاب, let's go visit أم أيمن just as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to visit her.
فلما قدم عليها تحدث عندها ثم بكت رضي الله عنها.
So when they went to her and they were speaking in front of her, she began to cry.
فقال لها ألا تعلمين أن ما عند الله خير لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مما عندنا؟
So they said to her, don't you know that whatever Allah has is better for the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم than what we have?
فقالت أعلم أن ما عند الله خير لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولكنني أبكي لأن الوحي انقطع من السماء لموت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
She said, I know that what Allah عزّ وجل has in store for him is better than what he has here on earth, but I'm crying because revelation from the heavens has been cut off.
إخواني ماذا أقول وماذا أترك أخبار عظيمة وأحوال جليلة إنهم خير الناس بعد الأنبياء رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم.
He the Sheikh says, I don't know what to say and what to leave out because there are so many various, you know, beautiful stories and beautiful narrations that show that the virtue of the Sahaba, may Allah Azza wa Jalla be pleased with them.
يقول الله عز وجل للفقراء المهاجرين يعني للفقراء المهاجرين.
Allah Azza wa Jalla says that the booty, the war booty, is for the fuqara, the poor migrants from Mecca.
الذين أخرجوا من ديارهم وأموالهم.
Those that were kicked out from their homes and from their wealth.
يبتغون فضلا من الله ورضوانه.
They're seeking bounties and pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وينصرون الله ورسوله.
And they're aiding Allah and His Messenger.
أولئك هم الصادقون.
Those are the ones that are truthful.
ثم قال في الأنصار.
Then he said regarding the Ansar.
والذين تبوأوا الدار والإيمان من قبلهم.
Those that had the residence and the faith before them.
يحبون من هاجر إليهم.
They love those that migrated.
ولا يجدون في صدورهم حاجة مما أوتوا.
And do not have anything in their chests that keep them away from giving what they have.
ويؤثرون على أنفسهم ولو كان بهم خصاصة.
And they give precedence over their own selves. They give precedence to others over themselves, even if they report.
ومن يوق شح نفسه فأولئك هم المفلحون.
And those that go against their own stinginess, then they are those that are the successful.
ثم قال تعالى في من يأتي بعد الصحابة والذين جاءوا من بعدهم يقولون ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان.
Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Allah azza wa jalla, he describes those that come after the Sahaba, and he says, and those that come after them, they say, O our Lord, forgive us, and those that have preceded us in faith.
يقولون ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم.
They say, oh Allah, forgive us and those that have come before us, our brothers in faith that have come before us, and do not make it put any hatred in our hearts against them.
ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم.
And then they say in the end, our Lord, you are compassionate and the most merciful.
فيا إخواني هؤلاء الصحابة رضي الله عنهم سيرتهم عطرة ترقق القلوب والمقصود بذلك ليس أن ترق قلوبنا فقط وإنما المقصود أن نحبهم وأن نتأسى بهم وأن نقتدي بهم وأن نسلك سبيلهم رضي الله عنهم وأرضاهم.
These Sahaba that are mentioned, they have very beautiful stories behind them. They have very beautiful biographies. And the point of all this is not just to mention stories, but rather to try to emulate them as much as possible and to act as they used to act.
ولعلنا في يوم غد إن شاء الله نكمل الحديث عن هذا الموضوع المهم ونذكر بعض المواقف العملية أو القولية للصحابة رضي الله عنهم.
And tomorrow, inshallah, we're going to continue this topic. We're going to talk about some of the situations that the Sahaba were in terms of their actions and their statements.
وأيضا نتحدث عن خطر الوقوع في الصحابة أو الكلام بالنقد لأصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإن هذا علامة الضلال.
And we're going to talk about the danger of talking evil about the Sahaba because this is a sign of misguidance.
ونسأل الله جل وعلا أن يجعلنا وإياكم ممن اتبع طريقة الصحابة وسار على منهاجهم.
We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make us from among those who follow the path of the Sahaba.
وهذا يلزم منه أن نتعلم العلم النافع وأن ندرس وأن نحضر حلقات العلم حتى نستفيد وحتى نتنور بطريقة الصحابة رضي الله عنهم.
And based on this, it makes it necessary for us to attend beneficial lectures and to try to benefit so that we can try to emulate the Sahaba.
وفي الختام نشكر الله سبحانه وتعالى على هذا اللقاء الطيب. ونسأل الله جل وعلا أن يجعله خالصا لوجهه نافعا للمسلمين.
And in conclusion, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the opportunity to give this lecture. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make it sincere for His sake and beneficial to the Muslims.
وأيضا نشكركم أنتم على يعني هذا الحضور وعلى هذا الاهتمام بالدروس العلمية ونسأل الله يجعلكم مباركين أينما كنتم.
And we thank you for your attendance and your keenness on being in beneficial lectures. We ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to make you all blessed wherever you are.
وأيضا نشكر أخانا الشيخ عمرو جزاه الله خير على الترجمة جزاه الله خيرا على ما يعني يبذله وفي إمامة المسجد أيضا.